Well, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us today to get to know Fabiola Jean-Louis. My name is Allison Hurrier, and I head up the textile arts curriculum at Portland State University. The textile arts is an elective track in the BFA program that provides an interdisciplinary approach to the study of clothing and textiles. We offer courses in weaving, surface design, sewing construction, and dress history. And this is one of several events that we're hosting this term that is bringing in outside perspectives to complement some of our coursework and things that are happening in the classroom. And actually facilitating the discussion today is Annan Barrett, our amazing instructor for the history of dress course this term. So please, if you're interested, check out the chat if you want to learn more about upcoming events or you are wanting to check out our event archive. This will be recorded and added to the archive later this week. We'll also be using the chat today to take questions. So please feel free to ask things as we go. If we don't get to your question right away, we will make sure to address it at the end of the talk. So before we get started, I would like to acknowledge that we are joining you all via Portland State University, which is located near the heart of downtown Portland, Oregon, in Multnomah County. We honor the Indigenous people whose traditional and ancestral homelands we stand on, the Multnomah, Kathlamet, Clackamas, Tumwater, Watlala bands of Chinook, and the Tualatin Kalapuya, and many other indigenous nations of the Columbia River. It's important to acknowledge the ancestors of this place and recognize that we are here because of the sacrifices forced upon them. In remembering these communities, we honor their legacy, their lives, and their descendants. Today, we are thrilled to welcome Fabiola Jean-Louis. Fabiola has garnered extensive acclaim for her incredible body of work, including Rewriting History, a three-part series consisting of fashion period paper gowns, painterly photographs, and Polaroids. Her images have been described as magical, moody, and mysterious, and also as visual activism, because she challenges the ways that we think in society and creates sort of conversations for things that we haven't seen before. Her work is being exhibited in major museums in the US and Europe and is creating huge buzz in the arts field. Fabiola, thank you so much for joining us today. We are so excited to have you for this virtual visit.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it. It's an honor. And my favorite audience to be speaking to are art students and creatives. So this is great. So a little bit about me. I was born in Haiti. I am based in Brooklyn right now. And so I go between Haiti and New York with my work. I am a mother of five. And I was a pre-med major in college and was 3 months away from going into or graduating and going into med school when I picked up a camera. So the rest, as they say, is history, but we'll get into that some more during this talk.
Yeah, we're so excited to hear about it. I'm curious, how did you, you do have like a really sort of different background, especially with the pre-med focus and whatnot. How did you get into art making? What was that journey and that path for you?
So as far as I can remember, I was always a creative child. My father is someone I would call kind of like a genius or a Renaissance man. He was always making things, always building. And so at a very young age, I was exposed to that. And I was in Catholic school for 8 years of my life. And so I decided the way out of all of that was to go to an artistic public school. I think around 13, I knew I wanted to be an artist. And I ended up going to Fashion Industries High School. And I don't know, I started a family really, really early at the age of 18, 19. So by the end of fashion, I had decided that I really disliked the industry. It was just too fake and too grimy for me. So I said, I'd rather just like hang out, with the crazy punk kids in Manhattan and be a mom. that's what I did. And so art kind of took a backseat for a very, very long time in my life. But 11 years later, after a marriage and divorce and two children, I decided that I needed to do something more serious with my life. And that's really a testament to the kind of pressure that I was getting from, you know, family and friends, where they didn't think that life as an artist was enough or responsible. And that's when I decided to enroll in a university for biology. And surprisingly, I did well in there and I wasn't prepared for that. So I said, okay, great, I'll become a doctor, I can do this. But I found that the 4 years of rigorous studying and staying on the dean's list and all of those things were really, really just causing my brain to melt. I just felt like my brain was oozing out of my ears. I was doing well, but I just kind of felt like I needed therapy from all of that. And so I started taking little dance classes and you know, incorporating some form of art into my life. I picked up a camera and I was like, wait a minute, what? And I never wanted to do photography. I was not interested in photography at all. So it was a big surprise to me. But then once I did that and it started taking over my life and, you know, I was like editing photographs at my day job more than I was doing my day job. That was kind of a sign. And then I started really thinking about my path and if medicine was really the right one for me. And then I really had to just make a decision that it was really for other people and it had nothing to do with me. So I took a chance and walked down my own path. Mm.
You mentioned that you're from Haiti originally, and how does Haiti continue to inspire you?
Wow. So, you know, as a Black woman, and not just as a Haitian woman, but as a Black woman, I've always felt that roots and magic is at the center of our strength. And when I say our, I mean of Black people. It's always been at the center of our strength and identity. And for me, Haiti is that. That magic that it has is something that I think that us, you know, our communities, Black communities, can tap into for strength. In fact, that's how the Haitian Revolution was won. Right, was tapping into that magic and roots of things. And Haiti plays a very special role for me in that. So I feel like whenever I need to speak with my ancestors and to remember that strength and to remember the magic that I'm really made of, that's where I go. You know, I automatically go into a space of where Haiti is. And that really dictates a lot of the work that I do.
Thank you.
Well, I know you talked a little bit about like your journey into the art world. I feel like I want to for those folks who haven't gotten time to spend a lot of time on your website, I wanted to just actually look at some images. I feel like this is some of like the earlier work that you were doing. Mm-hmm. Are you seeing that on the screen, Fabiola?
I can see it, yes.
Oh, great, fantastic. So
not as big. So I'm, though
you it's not what
it's not as big or expanded on my screen.
Oh, okay, let's see. Maybe Gigi, I know that you're in the chat. Can you see everything okay in terms of the screen that you're looking at? Do you see the slides?
Yeah, I'm also able to see the top of your screen. Mm-hmm. So it might not be in full like expanded view.
Well, we need to keep these tabs open, so
yeah. Okay, that's fine.
I'm glad that we're seeing the screen though, and everybody's seeing these really beautiful images that you've created. I'm curious, like how, so can you talk a little bit more, I mean, you talked a little bit about sort of the journey into portraiture, but like, or just photographs and things like that, but what about that format of image making is interesting to you?
So conceptual photography wasn't something that I even knew existed. So when I was looking for an art form that would allow me to communicate without using words, which is really, after these years, I've learned that that's what I was trying to do. I didn't want to use words to talk about what I was going through. And I stumbled across conceptual photography, and I was like blown away because you could do these levitation tricks, and you could do all these really interesting things. And I thought, you know, I, at heart, I'm a storyteller, and I get to use this language in a way that will speak to all the things that I'm thinking and I'm feeling. And so I automatically jumped into this, and then realized that I needed to learn Photoshop. And then I freaked out and I was like, no, I'm not doing this. But, you know, it was just that, but that's how I knew that the passion was that strong, because I forced myself to overcome my fear of Photoshop. And I just devoured it days, every day, every day, every day. And this is probably one of the first, not the first, but I would say maybe 2 months in to editing, or 3 months in of teaching myself things, that I did this image.
Yeah, can you talk a little bit, just, I'm so curious about this project. I think we've got two images here. Let me just make sure. Yeah, but what, like, can you tell us just where this kind of came from and a little bit more about what we're looking at?
Yeah, so, you know, well, first of all, I started in portraiture or self-portraiture because that's the only thing that I had access to at the time was myself. And there was this immediacy to that process that I was also very much interested in. Like, if I wanted to say something, I could use myself to do it, boom, done, edit, and I didn't have to worry about all the production of photography that, you know, usually goes into things. So this photograph really is a result of me feeling really, or more confident in front of the camera. In understanding movement myself. And this is about the time where I started thinking of myself as a time traveler, because I don't think I had actually thought of those words before to describe myself. Today, that is very much, I'm very much aware of that part of my identity. And what that means is that I'm just very present of history, the past, the present, and the future all kind of happening simultaneously. And that's something that I really wanted to try and convey in this photo.
I love that. I love that thematically. And then I also just, I mean, I feel like, especially for like students who are in the room, I think that like it's also is responding to this really real challenge too, of just like the making process of like, I have these ideas and I want to put them out there, and like, yeah, then thinking about the self and how the self is kind of involved with the actual, as the subject matter of the photo is really beautiful.
And something I want to add to what you just said is that, this process really taught me how to create works that did not require a large budget, did not require access to things. A lot of times artists get stuck, and I would imagine that some of the best ideas don't come to fruition just because of this idea or this misconception that you have to have access to money and supplies and all of these things to make it. And so this is really the beginning of me teaching myself to work within a space of limitations, because here is where I understood that the best ideas came from that space. You know, you create the best when you don't have, and so you have to find that very creative thing, ways to make it. So that this is the beginning of me learning those really awesome truths.
You're getting some agreement with that in the
chat. Yeah, for sure.
Really,
yeah,
I mean, stuck a nerve.
Specifically, yeah, with this, and I think people are really liking the idea of like of time, like just this idea of like identifying yourself as a time traveler as well. I don't know if that. I mean, yeah. I don't know if you want to speak any more to that, or maybe we'll.
Yeah. More. I mean, it's. I think not that everybody has to identify as that or believe in that, but honestly, I think that we all are. we're constantly pulling from the past and the history to inform our present. And we're constantly in the present, not just in the present, but looking to the future. And then we're also using the past to inform the future, which means that everything is really just kind of happening at once. And artists are really special in that way, that whether or not we realize it, we are activating that every single time we think about what we're going to make, and then we start making. So there's so much magic just in that in itself. This image that we're looking at right now, Reoccurrence Plot, this is a kind of fast forward from the last image, I would say about 6 months. So from that last image that we saw, I dropped out of of med school or pre-med, and I took my three children and I called my parents, and I was just like, I'm done. I'm not going to med school anymore. So I'm so sorry. Sorry to break your heart. And I think I'm gonna move back to New York and kind of give this photography thing a shot. So that within 6 months time from that photo, I was back in New York and I was commissioned to do a book cover. And this is the image that we're looking at right now. The Reoccurrence Plot, the title of this image is because that was the actual name of the book. And this is the first, I would say this is the first real professional gig that I had after claiming it. You know, like you have to claim it. You have to, my sister said to me, you know, oh, you're a professional artist now. And I was like, no, you know, this is just a hobby. And she said, if you don't stop saying that and you don't claim it, I'm gonna hang up on you right now. And I won't talk to you again until you claim it. I claimed it and then I got this gig. So yeah.
That's great. We were actually just having like an amazing conversation yesterday in a BFA class that I teach about commissions and also how to like intersect kind of commissions with your like with your interests, right? So it's nice to know that this like had this sort of, you know, very like a bit of a commercial sort of application, yeah. But it's still work that like reflects you and how you like and you're passionate about it. So
exactly. I mean, the beauty of what was happening in the very beginning of my career was that I knew if somebody was coming to me to commission me, it was because they knew what I had to offer. Right. So you're not going to come to me if you don't want something that's not like this. And that was great for, I would say, for the first year. And then I would say, or the second year. And I was doing a few album covers. I was working with different musicians and other projects. And then I came to the conclusion that they do eventually suck you dry. And you know, everyone has their own vision for what they want in a collaboration. And you're really gonna have to, as an artist, sacrifice a lot of that, of what you want to make their project come to life. And I really just got to the point where I was like, there's so much more that I want to do with my work that I just completely stopped. So I haven't done commissions in four years. Yeah.
I don't know. Annan, did you have questions about some of this work?
I do. Fabiola, on your website, you mentioned that you love fairies and elves, folklore mm-hmm. and science fiction. And maybe you could talk a little bit more about how these themes come together in your work.
Can you tell? She's a lady. you know, so growing up, my very, very, very most favorite movie was Dark Crystal. Labyrinth, I'm old school. So, you know, I grew up with some really dope, amazing, magical movies. Jim Henson was the bomb. And when I started doing this work, I and conceptual photography specifically, I knew that I wanted to put some of those ideas into the work. And so folklore really is just pulling from old stories, old things, and just adding a little my own style to it. It doesn't always necessarily pertain to a specific folkloric story. You know, you're not going to look at it and say, oh, that's Alice in Wonderland or, you know, some other story. But I think what I'm really tapping into when I say folklore is the understanding of this being in another world, you know, not of the world that we are attached to, but something that's so much more beyond that and magical. And that's really at the core of the work too. It's really trying to go past where we're used to being and having my viewer kind of feel like they're in this magical other space.
Mm-hmm. One that challenges time and place.
All of that, right?
All of it. Yeah. Yeah, that's, I think, why they are such powerful images.
So this was taken in Prospect Park with a bunch of people around me. You obviously can't see them there, but thinking that I was absolutely crazy in broad daylight. This was done, it was like the sunniest day ever during the summer. And I just had a mood. I just had a feeling. And, you know, I have what some people might call a dark side, you know, kind of morose, if you will. I call it a little moody, whatever. But, you know, even on the sunniest day of the summer, I wanted to create this very moody piece that was mysterious and maybe slightly scary or creepy. So this piece came out of that. And again, this is what I love about the process. I needed to create something, and I needed this immediate gratification as well. Sometimes it's not, but in this case it was. And I went to the park, I had this little lantern, and I found a log. And out of that came an entire photograph. You know, so it just adds to that lesson of you don't need much to make something that you stand behind and love.
Mm-hmm. And what about the title? Such an interesting title, In a Haze.
In a Haze. Yeah, you know, it can feel like that for me, I think, or not even like that for me, but I think maybe for my viewers, it can feel like, what world did I just enter just now? You know, like when you're transitioning from what you're normally attached to, and now you're looking at this image, I'm kind of asking my viewer to totally disconnect in a way, you know, like disconnect from what you're used to and what you think you want to see, and enter my world. And so I imagine that feeling like a haze, you know, maybe a little bit of confusion, maybe, you know, you can't see what's in front of you just yet, and then it just appears to you. So I think that title really just speaks to what I imagine it feeling like when disconnecting.
Great.
There was a question actually related to this image and maybe some of the ones that we saw earlier. It's a technical question, but it's from Britta. And Britta's asking, how do you take photos of floating women?
So the short answer is it's called creating different plates. So what you don't see is that the model is laying on a platform or a step. And so I think what I had that day was a step, and I kind of had her put her stomach on the step, and I did the photo in parts. So conceptual photography is always done in parts. So you're going to take a plate, and the plate is that the model is not in the scene at all. You just photograph the entire scene, all of it. And then you include the model in it, and then you photograph her on the stool, whatever she's laying on. And then in Photoshop, what ends up happening is, because you have all these plates that kind of match up, you can literally just erase that stool out of that, because you already photographed a blank plate, not a blank plate, but a plate behind it of the scene. So it sounds very techy and nerdy and confusing, but she really is just laying on something that in Photoshop, because I had maybe 30 or 40 images, I was able just to take it right out and you wouldn't see it.
Thank you for that. I wanted to move on to your Polaroid series and just talk a little bit about that. Can you just, like, what was your inspiration for this work, and what were some of the intentions behind creating these images?
I am obsessed with Polaroids, I'm also obsessed with old vintage photographs, daguerreotypes, but it's such a process that I haven't been able to learn how to do those, and don't have the space for them. So the go-to for me became Polaroids. You know, I could get something similar, and I, again, would get that instant gratification. So I started just experimenting with Polaroids, if you will. And then what I realized is, I started noticing as a photographer that everyday life moves so fast, and we miss so much. There's so many things that our eyes don't see, and our perceptions trick us into thinking is reality, which is not, right? And I became more and more fascinated by this idea and how a slow shutter on the camera could slow things down so much that you catch something that otherwise you would have missed. And so really it was an experiment of trying to see what the camera would catch that my own human eye wasn't catching. In that space, in that space, I wondered, am I capturing the magic of us humans? I mean, is there a magical truth to us in this space, that blur, you know, the thing that the imagination goes wild on? And so that just made me go crazy for Polaroids even more. And so I actually have a project that I haven't really put out yet, which is an all slow shutter project that is a mixture of Polaroid and digital, but it's just all very moody, like this, black and white. Also, the thing about the Polaroids and doing them in black and white as opposed to color is that color is too guiding of a story. It automatically tells you, or the viewer, in my opinion, what you're looking at. You know the shirt is red or the pants are blue and the colors of the background, you know a huge chunk of the story already. There's not much left to the imagination. But black and white goes beyond that for me, because now it forces the mind to start figuring out what these things are. What is that color? I can't tell the tone. And it forces the viewer, in my opinion, to think more, to pause more at a photograph. We live in a society today that is so fast, and with Instagram and everything, people are scrolling images without barely spending two seconds on them. And so there's so much information that we miss. And oftentimes, because there's color, we're like, oh, okay, the mind already is registering that. So we're a scroll society, is what I call us. And I like that black and white forces that to slow down just a little bit.
I will scroll through a couple of the things from this project. So, were you gonna?
Yeah, I noticed that this perhaps could even be perceived as the next moment from the previous slide. I don't know if that is possible reading or not, but.
So good observation. So the last photograph, so these two sisters, these twin sisters hired me to photograph them. And the last photograph was with a digital camera. Well, this isn't digital, but I took the same exact camera or the same exact picture with a digital camera. So I had both my Polaroid and digital next to me. So I took the digital and they loved it. And I was just like, you know what? They're giving me so much magic right now. There was so much more that I thought that the Polaroid would get. So I grabbed that and I shot this image. And then the next image, I was like, okay, we're actually done with your shoot now that you hired me for. We're gonna do my own project now. So I stood them up and then I had them just move. And they one of them literally asked me, like, what are you having us do right now? Like, they weren't used to moving in that way. And I was just like, just swing your arm, just be natural. And they did. And the Polaroid caught this, and which is exactly what I was just talking about and what I wanted to get and what I thought the camera would capture is there's a magic in between our reality and the camera. Or yeah. in between what exactly, I don't know, but I know that our reality is on one end of that, right? And I knew the camera was gonna get these nuances of movement that obviously I was never going to see. And what we end up seeing is this. It is one of my favorite photographs. My gallery was like, the owner of the gallery was like, no, we're not gonna take it because, you know, I think it's just too, it's beautiful, but it may not sell. And then the other gallerist said, we're gonna take it. Mm-hmm. And this is like one of the best selling pieces of the Polaroids because of that, yeah.
Can you explain this right here, the detail on the left in the middle? Does that look like, is it a hand?
Right in between their heads?
No, right on the here. Left side, yeah.
That is, so that's a flaw. That's another thing that I love about the Polaroid, flaws. That's a quote unquote flaw of what came out of the camera. And so, you know, once the chemicals spread over on the slide, on the Polaroid sheet, you don't really know which way it's going to go sometimes. And it just creates all these like weird flaws. And I love them so much. Mm-hmm. And that's what I also look for. And what I love about Polaroid as opposed to digital is that it's imperfect. Digital is just too crispy and too perfect. It's not dreamy and moody enough. This has character to me. Not that I don't love my old work or my digital work today, I do, but I don't think that I would enjoy photography as much if I wasn't also doing Polaroids.
Allison, Fabiola, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
I can hear you.
Sorry. So I am into cottagecore and unicorns and mermaids. I do cosplay and I'm a costume artist. And I really love photography and what you've done here. And a lot of times in photography, there are these flaws or like when I take color photography, a lot of times I really like to play with the sunlight and natural elements out in nature. And there are these orbs or like halos or like rainbows. And I noticed, like, I just kind of pretend like they're fairies. Like that's like the evidence that they're actually magic or spirits in the world. And that's like one of my favorite things, to go through old photos and look at these weird phenomenons, like kind of how on the edge of the right corner of the dress, how you see the ruffles, but they're not there. It's like, there's her, like a ghost of where she was a few moments ago, you know?
Yeah.
Like how you're talking about, like, and there's different realms between our eyes and our brain's perception and what might also be out there that we don't know of, or we just imagine that might be out there just for fun. Mm-hmm. But then the camera seems to create these illusions that I really enjoy in photography. So there's this thing called Black Fade. I don't know if you've heard of it, but there's a lot of African-American people doing cosplay and trying to like capture the kind of images like this. To me, they look like angels or ghosts.
So I wouldn't necessarily say that these things are not magical. The orbs and the flaws that we get, I think they are there. They are reflective of our natural world and our environment and what's actually being caught. We don't see that. And I think that's a great job for the artist, whether you're a photographer or a painter or whatever, is to try to see the magic that's constantly around us and then to use that in our conversations somehow.
Yeah.
Definitely. I think one of the things that I sort of really respond to as well. I mean, so there's this kind of like unexpected, this is kind of leading into our next question too, but like there's this unexpected thing that happens in terms of like the processing of the photo, which feels like it's really important to this work. But I feel like there's also just this lovely kind of like unexpectedness that happens just with the collaboration between like the models that you're working with and like what they're kind of bringing into the conversation as well. And I see your hand, I see a hand. Would you mind just typing your question in the chat for us? Like, with that? Thank you so much. The thing I wanted to kind of just ask you about next was that kind of collaboration element. And I think Annan had some questions about that too, in terms of thinking about the care with which, like just what that is like and sort of how the models contribute to the photos and then also what that process is in terms of working with the models. And I know we got a video we were gonna show as well.
Yeah, there's another couple of Polaroids though.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, let's.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so this is paper, but she's wearing a paper collar. And so the collaboration with my models is a very, very special one. I spend more time talking to them and learning a little bit about them than I do shooting them, to be honest. I find that that's the best way to get from my subject what I'm looking for, is if I build some sort of a relationship with them first and make them feel comfortable. The other beautiful thing about a Polaroid as opposed to a digital is that it's less intimidating to a subject, to a model. It almost looks like a toy to them. And you know, a lot of them know what it's like to have a Polaroid or Instax. So it's like a plaything as opposed to this big camera, you know, that has this huge lens. And so it's easier to photograph them sometimes with the Polaroid, but once I learn them a little bit and we talk and I tell them exactly what I'm looking for, my next job really often is just to help them relax and learn their bodies in a second. Like, and that's not easy. What I mean by that, learn their bodies in a second, is oftentimes they think that they already know how to move, and they think that, you know, there are, or they don't pay attention to their body movements at all on a daily basis. And now all of a sudden I'm asking them to do a soft hand or be aware of the turn of the wrist. These are things that you develop either as a dancer or you naturally have grace or something else, but you're very aware of that. And so I have to teach my models this thing in like a 1 minute crash course of this is how you should move, and you know, just turn around and look like this. So with this particular image, even I just said, just turn your head to the side for me and just look at me. Look at me and look through me. And she gave me exactly that. But that was, it was part of the conversation that we were having prior to that. So I shot her for maybe 5 or 10 minutes, and I was able to get like 20 amazing images out of her. Yeah. And I think there's another one with the backside of her head.
Yes.
This is another favorite seller at the gallery and with my own private collectors, Road to Freedom. This one I love so much, and it does so well because she almost looks like a butterfly with the collar on. But then really what I was talking about was I noticed when I turned her around that she had this like almost straight part in the back of her head, and hair in Black culture is very, very important. And I was using her part, this almost straight line, to talk about my hopes that freedom really was a straight line, that there wasn't all these twists and turns to try to get to something that we should all have as human beings, but that it wasn't. And so I was like using Black hair and this part in her head to talk about that.
Beautiful.
Wonderful. There's a question from Britta about your process again. Wondering if you'd have the opportunity to work with silver gelatin prints because your process is reminding her of photograms and cliche there.
Yes, I have not, and I want to. See, this is the thing that when things kind of slow down for me, that I will be going into. I my dream is to have turn a bathroom in my home into a dark room and or whatever, and just experiment with photographs to get them to look like this every time. Like this old, very moody vibe is something that speaks to me and my spirit on a daily basis. It's really like the way that I see the world often. And so no, even though I haven't done it yet, I think that's what this work is, what I'm gearing myself to do in the future.
Cool. Great. Well, I think we have a lot of people who are eager to see rewriting history series that you did.
And three-dimensional sculptures.
This is the very first dress that I ever created for the Rewriting History collection.
Yeah. And can you, I mean, should we, would it be?
Yeah. Yeah. I'll tell you a little bit about it before. Yeah. So this is the very first dress. I woke up with a title in my head and did not know what I was going to do. I knew I wanted to do some work that spoke to injustice and spoke to the time. And rewriting history, so back to the part of the conversation where I was talking about not having money as an artist, not having access to things. I knew I wanted to do a series that would incorporate fabrics or period gowns. And when I looked at what the fabrics would cost to make them, I just about fell out my seat. I could not afford it. So I almost nixed the idea because I thought, oh, you know, I can't make it the way that I want to. Thank God I didn't do that, because the next day I woke up with the title of Rewriting History and thinking about the Constitution and the power of the Constitution and the fragility of the Constitution at the same time. And you know, paper as currency to buy human bodies. And I thought, I need to make this out of paper somehow. And then I just jumped into teaching myself how to figure this out. And this is where Fashion Industries High School comes into play, because I had to tap into all of that old stuff to figure this out. And so the video you're about to watch is the completion of the dress and the first photo shoot ever.
So here we go.
Thank you.
God, it's been years since I've seen that. Oh my God.
It's so wonderful to see how you work with your models so intimately, really. Yeah. So with so much care and love. So
this image, this, the process is not linear. Oftentimes I go back. And that also, again, time traveling, right? So this, I photographed her twice because I didn't know where rewriting history was going to go the first time I shot her from the video that you just saw. I had this one idea that it was going to look this way and very photographic and not necessarily fairy tale-ish. But then I did this image just in case on the side to be a little bit more fairy tale-ish. And then if you go to the next image, it's the same dress, same model. This is where I decided what rewriting history was going to end up looking like. And so by this photograph, I had done three or four other images in rewriting history at this point. And I said, okay, so I have to do this dress again. I have to shoot it again so that it fits the aesthetic. So a lot of times I go back, even to the point of making a dress, I go all the way back. And we can talk more about that when we're further down looking at, you know, some of the dresses that I'm creating for these new events. But going back and changing things and, you know, repackaging them, not for the audience, but just for myself so that I understand where I'm trying to go is a very important part of the process.
For sure. And I feel like that video to me, it just like brings together all the different like elements of all the things that you're working with as well. It just is such a perfect.
I felt tired all over again, just watching that. Like I remember collapsing, giving them hugs at the end was literally me collapsing in her arms because of all that it took to bring this thing to life. I just felt like, thank God I did it. Like that. It could be back there.
I'm curious, I mean, just because the historical fashion component is such a big part of this project, what was your research process like for doing this? What were you looking at and how did that work?
So I was looking at primarily the Constitution. I was looking at things relating to American government. I was looking at the present condition of American society, the constant killing of Black men and women by police officers when I started rewriting history. And so those were my immediate go-tos for research, if you will. And I knew that I wanted the image, the first image that I created to be very, very impactful with where the rewriting history series was going to go. And so this was actually what ended up being the first image released in the collection, not the other one, but it was this one because I felt like it would do that. It would set the tone with my viewers as far as like where I was going to go and what conversations I was interested in having. Later on, my research starts to develop more. And so if you're looking at this dress from a fashion standpoint, historical fashion standpoint, it's not entirely historically correct, right? It's not something that you would go into a pattern book and necessarily find because this was my idea of that. And a lot of times my designs are not exact replicas. They're suggestive, they're how I'm taking that concept and tweaking it to be my own. And that's what this dress was. Later on, I actually start using pattern books and really, really building my library to include a lot of museum catalogs so that I could see, and paintings. I always, always look at paintings almost first. I'll find a painting, if I'm trying to do a recreation of something, I'll find a painting. And then I will do the research on the painting and then I'll try and see if this dress is still in existence, if a museum has it and if it's in a catalog. And then I'll try to recreate it from that way. Otherwise, I use a lot of pattern books.
And this print shows the newsprint, the newspaper as part of your materials here. Does that have a significance?
At first I thought that it would, and it wasn't that the, a lot of people ask me, what book did you use for this? You know, like, this is that, cause I do a lot of hidden meaning in my work as well. And to be honest with you, it wasn't that the words were specific to the Constitution itself, is that words were, I was being specific about the power of words in itself. And I used a book, you know, if you had to ask me what book I used for this, it was probably something on the French Revolution and Marxism, you know, like some of the stuff that were important to the story, but not really, not specific to it. But it was really talking about words on paper and how we use that in our society to control and to break down and do all of these things. So there's no specific book in this project, in this work right here.
Got it.
I am going to maybe just kind of scroll through some images, and you just let me know when you want to stop, Fabiola. And while we're doing that, we do have a question in the chat about, do you have a favorite pattern book that you tend to go to?
Okay. So before I answer that question, so this is the, as I was talking to you guys before about me going back and doing things again, this is a perfect example of that, because this is a newer version of the dress you just saw. So I decided that I had reached a new place in my work. And this is, I would say, maybe 2 years down the line from the beginning of rewriting history, where the technique had changed and gotten better. So the first dress that you saw was made out of newsprint paper. It's not archival, it's very delicate. I used acrylic paint, which damages the paper a lot and doesn't allow it to survive longer. So this dress, I was like, okay, so now I want to do more archival work and I want to include light in my work in some way. And this was approaching my first solo show ever. And I had redone all of these new dresses to look like this. And so I decided to remake that last dress that you just saw to have the aesthetic that I wanted it to have. So this is a 2.0 of the other dress. And sorry, the question was, what was the question?
Oh, it was just, I mean, do you use patterning texts? Like, or do you?
It's a black book. Oh, gosh. I'm trying to remember the book. It's a very thin, long book that is almost like a landscape. It's a weird book. I don't remember the name of it, but it's used by a lot of fashion students, and it's not very thick, but it has all the periods. I think there's like a 1, 2, and 3. So you can do these different, like 19th century, 18th century, and so on. That's probably one of my more favorite books to use. But also I really do adore the museum catalogs the most, to be honest with you. I'm not working with fabric, and so paper is more forgiving. And the pattern books can only take me so far, because they're talking about working with fabric. And so you have to follow all of these rules. So to me, I see those books as rule books. and I'm breaking rules, really. And so I'm not really interested in looking at books too long that are full of rules. I want to look at pictures that just give me the essence and idea of what I'm trying to create out of paper, if that makes sense. And so that's why the museum catalogs tend to be my favorite, because I can zoom in and try to figure out what I'm trying to figure out on paper.
Yeah, you're a sculptor. It's working sculpture. I am gonna just, because I do want to make sure we get to some of the you're doing too. So I'm just gonna kind of slowly scroll through these. I know Molly is asking if you have a favorite tool that you use in the studio.
I do. I have a few of my favorite tools. My favorite tools are tweezers, clothespins, believe it or not. I use clothespins for everything. Wood glue is my other favorite. And now, because I'm doing paper mosaic work, the cutters are also my favorite. I think I would say that those are my favorite, clothespins and my clay tools.
I am curious, like, because we just passed through some sculpture, like work that's just pure sculpture, and it feels like that's what the second iteration of this gown was. And then we have additional work that has people in it. Like, what, how does the like presence of the body affect? I mean, there's obviously the like functional aspects of having to work with a body, but like, how does it change the work for you in terms of how you read it, and then also
it brings it alive, honestly. Yeah. The thing with paper is that it's so static in a lot of ways. It's static. And when you're making something, when you're using paper to make a dress that normally would have shapes and flow in a certain way to complement the human body, to add that life, you know, that what it means for me is that now my model has to take on even extra life, because she's got to have her own personality and what she brings to the table. But then she's got to figure out how to bring this very static material to life and make it look like it's not paper. So it's more complicated than people think. But the human body, I rely on for that, because without it, it would just be a paper sculpture, which I'm not putting that down. I think by itself, that's amazing. But still, the human body, what I'm looking for is to make the human body bring this static thing to life.
Yeah, so I'll kind of continue scrolling through, and then I know that we'll eventually kind of get to atonement here.
The next slide, there.
Yeah. A new project.
Yeah, so Fabiola, you wrote that this project, Atonement, Paradise Lost, is a reflection of your life. It's a journey of realizing impermanence, fear, guilt, and years of Catholic school. So can you say more about this?
Yeah, so the work is really, I'm still going to be making the paper sculptures. So the whole, everything in this piece almost is paper, the headpiece and with 24 karat gold. This is a self-portrait, by the way. And people didn't realize at the time, because it was a secret, not really a secret, but I hadn't told the public that I was pregnant. So I was 6 months pregnant in this photograph, and I really wanted to speak to that. But then thinking of my baby as this new magical creature that I was adding into this world, and then really reflecting on myself and what I've gone through and how religion has shaped me. And so where rewriting history was looking at the Constitution, I really wanted to look at another item in our history that has also shaped our world, and that's the Bible. And we know where the Constitution and money is really important. Religion and the Bible also is very important in how we interact with one another. And so it became clear to me that would be the next paper project, if you will, was to talk about religion and the paper that goes into the building of this idea, you know, of all of these ideas and how we incorporate that. And then even deeper, how that shapes the Black identity and the Black presence and how we navigate throughout society with that. And even more specifically, thinking about Haiti and how voodoo overlaps with Catholicism, because Haiti is one of those very weird and special places in that way where that happens.
Mm-hmm. So is this series ongoing, the Atonement series?
So yes, so this was the very first image that I released last year, but then I had no idea that these other events were gonna come up and I'd be commissioned to do sculpture. So I had to put it on pause to do these commissions. So I will be jumping back into Atonement after my much needed break in January.
And then these are some of those projects that you're working on, more recent projects and things that you're working on now. Do you want to tell us about them?
Well, this is an old project, actually, but Seneca Village as a subject keeps coming up. And I think that's what you meant, is that it... Yes. Seneca Village, this is when I was still doing commissioned photo shoots, and I was hired to photograph this designer's clothes that was focused on Seneca Village. So I did this project, and then I would say now, just a few months ago, the Met came to me wanting me to add a sculpture to their Seneca Village project. So the next slides of the process is me working on paper clay. So because I'm obsessed with paper, my job really is often to try to figure out how to do something in paper where it normally isn't. So I needed to figure out how to do tiles out of paper. And that's what this image with the flower is a tile that I made out of paper clay, and the inspiration for the color. And the next side image is me laying it down. This is a very important part of my process right here. This is a new step in my work, honestly, because the seated sculpture that you see there, I had never been confronted with doing a seated dress before. Yes, it's one thing to put it on a model where she's gonna sit. It's gonna form to the human body in a certain way, and the model can like shape it that way, and it'll warm up and shape. But to have a static sculpture in a seated position is something I'd never done before. And I got very excited here because this is me answering that and figuring it out. And the other dress is for the Isabella Gardner Museum. And that, so that white dress that you just saw with me in it, it became the next slide.
Oh, okay.
This. And that's what will be worn for the event. One of the dresses that will be worn for the event next week.
This is the debut. Nobody has seen these yet.
Yes, yeah. We're getting a really awesome sneak peek because nobody knows that this is coming. This dress is all Haiti. So this is me stepping totally out of period gowns like Atonement and doing my own. These are my own designs. These are not recreations. These are not, this is me really putting my designer foot forward as far as like how I design costumes. And this is also all Haiti. The center, even though you may not be able to see it, is a saint called the Isali Danto, which is a Loa spirit. Other people might think that she's the Mother Mary. People might think that she's the Black Madonna of Poland. But for us in Haiti, she's Isali Danto. So this is an all entirely Haitian inspired gown for the first time. So I'm very excited about that. And this is the seated sculpture that you saw in white. And this is what became of it. This is for the Met. So again, you guys are getting a sneak peek because no one at the Met, aside from the curators, have seen it yet. This is before I attached the gold sleeves on it. It was just like an image I had to send the museum to say, this is where I'm at. I hope y'all are good with it. And so they were excited. So we're good. But this is where the work is going. So this is Seneca Village again for me, but the design of the room that they are creating at the Met is Seneca, is based on Seneca Village, but with an Afrofuturistic element to it, which is very strong in the project. And so the job for me was to figure out how to create kind of like a spirit energy, female energy in that room. And so she actually is going to be center stage in the room at the Met.
Fabulous. We just have a note in the chat about a link to that Met Museum exhibit with some background information about Seneca Village, a creative community in Manhattan in the 1800s.
Yes.
Right.
I can't wait to see it. I'm going to be there next month.
Great. It's going to be wonderful. It has so many amazing, amazing artists that are in the show. And honestly, I'm still like, I know how I got here because I was doing the work, but I don't know how I got here because it's only been, 5.5 years since I started this process, this journey. So it's still like crazy.
Anna, we might need to read.
Yeah,
link.
I see.
Okay, great. So,
thank you.
Yeah, no, and I think that's the other thing that I think it's just your journey over the last 5 years is just so incredible. And I think that it's so inspiring, I think, too, for like, just students who are in this process where they're trying to figure it out or maybe sort of finishing school and things like that, is that really like there's all sorts of possibilities of where it can go in a pretty quick period of time. And I can't wait to see what you're doing with Atonement after this, because it sounds like that's going to build a lot further as well. Thank as soon you. As you have the much needed break. I think we are at the end of the slides now.
We can do Q&A if they're
That's what I was going to say. I mean, I think if folks have questions, if you want to type them in the chat, or if you have a question that you would actually like to raise your hand and be brave and unmute yourself, this is the time. Otherwise, anybody out there in Zoom land?
Yeah. So if no one has questions, I can definitely add.
What does Afrofuturism mean to you, from Rose?
So I like that part of the question to me, because it does have different meanings to everyone. For me, it's about claiming space as a Black person and reimagining how we have power and we have strength and we have freedoms. And it's also just it's just honoring the Black imagination as well. The Black imagination has given us so many amazing people throughout time. I mean, I wouldn't even be able to list all of them, but you know, Octavia Butler and James Baldwin and all of these amazing, brilliant minds and things like that. But I think for me, Afrofuturism is being able to take the beautiful things that we are and who we are, and I'm hearing that ding. I'm sorry. I'm trying to process my thought on that one. But it's about excellence for me, Black excellence. And Black excellence is so many things. It's not an Ivy League college. It's not all of these things that say that we have benefits or we have privileges, but it's being able to make space and be a magical creature that we are, and having people allow that space to happen. And that's not the full answer for me, because I've been spending a whole lot of time on that question, which is probably why I'm at a loss for words right now, because I'm still processing what that is. It's honestly really weird to get that question as a Black person, because I'm constantly everyday Black. and I'm a time traveler at the same time. So I'm it, I'm now, I am that. If you ask me what's Afrofuturism, I'd say that's me, to be honest. But you know, Black people are that in itself. So it's kind of hard to break that apart in a lot of ways. I hope I answered the question and made sense.
Thank you. There's another question from Sammy, who said that you said that acrylic paint and newspaper were not a good mix. So what are you using now for your paper sculptures?
So I have my favorites. I use some Korean handmade paper. So for instance, the green paper on the bottom of this dress is Korean handmade paper that's dyed. And then I use mulberry paper. Everything that unless I'm using the Korean dyed paper, everything is white, starts white. So I use some craft paper and other archival paper. So really my collection of my favorites are about 3 to 4 types of paper. And with the colors, I use inks, water-based inks, sometimes use alcohol-based inks. And then every now and then I still do use acrylic, but I don't use that as the main base color, because that's what cracks all of the paper. So like I can use that on the black trimming if I want for the ruffles, but I won't use that on everything. And then of course I use 24 karat gold almost for everything. If it's gold on other than these paper sleeves that you're looking at, like the lapels or the epaulettes at the top, that's 24 karat gold. And the snake The snakes are 24 karat gold.
I know we have a question from, looks like the core classroom, which is really exciting. Do you all want to unmute yours? Look at you. Yay.
Hi, guys.
Do you all want to unmute yourselves and ask?
Yeah. You had mentioned in one of the pieces.
Oh, I'll get it.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay, sorry. Yeah, so you'd mentioned previously that like you had a lot of training in fields that aren't necessarily like traditionally thought of as artistic, and you've like brought that sometimes like into your work. And I was wondering, like, when you feel like, when do you feel called to do that? What situations kind of bring that out? And like, what do you think you get from that?
Like from bringing, from bringing parts of my life into the work? Would you say that last part again of the question? I don't think they can hear me. Did you understand that question? Maybe I think I missed a part.
Oh, because I think they turned down their volume in order to have the echo situation not happen. So I'm gonna have them type the question into the chat, so.
Okay, yeah.
Meanwhile, we have another question from Jody. Do you feel any great desire to interact with other artists and creative people?
Of course. I've collaborated before, and I will collaborate again. I love collaborating with other artists and seeing where different minds come together to create something really interesting. Another one of my dreams and my passion is to do stop motion photography / film and projecting my work. So the reason why I got so excited about this sitting position and figuring out how to do it was because, as you can see, she's missing a head and hands. And so I would love in the future now to pair up with a digital artist, I don't know what they would be called, that can do projection or holograms that would add hands and a head to this very still sculpture. So now you have these human parts that are moving. So that I know is going to require collaboration with another artist so that I can learn also how to do that. So yeah, that's definitely in the works.
Exciting. Sadie Lee asks, what kinds of Polaroid do you use and how big are the original prints?
Oh, they're tiny. So like 3.5 by 5 inches. My favorite Polaroid is the Spectra Polaroid. Unfortunately, don't make the film anymore. But so now I'm using more the basic square format. But I have a collection of them. So I work anywhere from the 600 Polaroid to whatever. I think I have like maybe 9 Polaroids. I love the Land camera as well, where you use the peel apart film. My parents can't stand me right now because I have their fridge filled with old film, but that's something that I love to do and what I work with.
Have you ever considered using papyrus and doing an Egyptian history collection? Would you ever go back that far in history?
Absolutely. Egypt is a very important place for me historically, and when thinking about my Black identity. And so I have a secret obsession with Egypt, actually. It's very interesting that you bring that up. But eventually, the challenge that I'm facing right now is that being one person and not having a full team yet, I am getting to the point where I'll have to hire an assistant and a studio manager. But that's the challenge, is that how do I spread myself to do all of these projects, right? Because that going out of just doing photography into more sculptural work has made things more complicated, because now I'm just more spread out, you know, and now I'm doing like altar shrines like behind me and figure out how to do that. So I don't know. I think I need like another 100 years of life to do all the projects that I really want to do. But yes, I definitely want to do that.
I can relate to needing the 100 lives as an artist.
Cool. So we had that question back from the group. So you mentioned that your art, that you've had training, schooling in fields that are not traditionally thought of as artistic, such as pre-med. I was wondering when you feel called to pull on that sort of your life.
Okay, so.
And if that process, if you could elaborate on that process in general.
So in my studio, I'm looking at a small sculpture or like a medical, skeleton. And I have a full life-size spine in my studio too. So medicine is very much a part of my process, understanding and remembering what I learned in medical school as far as like the human body is concerned is really important for me. And also just, it inspires me because I'm always thinking about the beginning of life, the beginning of a cell and the break, the duplication of cells and all of those things. And I think that if I didn't have the understanding of science like I do, I don't know that it would feed the imagination I have with that today. So it's all to say that it's very much a part of my creative process on a daily basis.
Excellent. I know we're over time. Do you have time for two more questions?
Is I have time. I'm okay. Loving it.
So I hope I'm not missing any questions, but not necessarily entirely related, but the sci-fi, like science, and then also the sci-fi fantasy aspect of your art, that's something that I know a lot of our students are really inspired by right now. Mm-hmm. What is the most meaningful aspect of sci-fi fantasy art and the genre as a whole to you?
Wow, it just gives you an excuse to make something that that doesn't really exist. I still haven't decided the answer to this yet, but I'm almost convinced that sci-fi has informed our society, where it didn't exist before, but like Steven Spielberg made a movie about it and did some sci-fi thing, and then all of a sudden science is trying to figure out how to make this thing happen, right? So I fully believe that the field of sci-fi is really important to how our society moves and informs the future in a lot of ways. And so as an artist, I use that to try to figure out how I can be a part of that in some way. How can I create something that's going to inform the future, and that is also part of my Afrofuturism, right? And even if you're not a Black artist and you're not laying claim to being Afrofuturist, it's really about like trying to like creating something that doesn't necessarily exist, and if it does, doing something that speaks to the technology and the science in our world. So I love that.
The question from Gigi about patterns. It's very easy to find European dress patterns, but not so much for other cultures. Have you been able to find any printed guides to traditional Haitian garment textile making? Or is that knowledge more passed down through other methods?
Good question. To be honest with you, I haven't looked for traditional Haitian garments because just from the look of things and understanding the garments that we wore, it's very straightforward. So there were no, unless they were rich in Haiti and wearing, the dress of the time, which was coming from Europe, really it was there was no bustle, there was no extra anything other than the ruffles and these flowy shirts. So I haven't needed to use any patterns to figure those designs out, is what I'm trying to say, is that they're so simple that all one needs to know is, once you have a pattern from one thing, you can kind of break everything down from there.
Related to the just patterning and dresses, what is the biggest challenge of making these intricate dresses out of paper? It still blows my mind that you're able to do these dresses out of newsprint.
There are so many challenges. So obviously the biggest one is that paper tears. But with that comes the ability to mend it and fix it. I think I'm going to say something that most people don't expect me to say. The biggest challenge isn't the paper, it's the colors. Because if I've mixed colors and I'm guessing how much color I'm going to use, most of my colors are mixed by myself. So I don't have, especially if I'm using inks, right? Like there's a specific color that I'm after. I have to mix that myself. The biggest challenge now is that I've underestimated how much of that color that I need. And dang it, I need to make more, but that is not going to mix. It's not going to match perfectly the other color that I had done already. So that happens almost every time. And I've gotten to the point where I have to mix like buckets of that same color just to make sure that I have the same tone. But that's the hardest part for me, is making sure that the colors are always on point. Paper is just really fun and forgiving. So it's really not that bad.
Mm-hmm. A question from Atima. Your Polaroid work is really fascinating. Her favorite one is the butterfly one, because of how you view and incorporate what some might view as technical accidents into your art. She's curious if those technical difficulties or accidents with the camera ever interrupt your vision, or if you are open to wherever the work ends up.
I love that. I am always open. This journey as a photographer and a paper artist has taught me how to let go, because paper is so fragile. I know it's going to tear and it's going to get ruined over time. I've had to let go. And that's informed me as a photographer as well, to love the flaws and to leave myself open to anything that comes up. So when I see that accident, I am so happy, to the point now where that if I don't see it, I'm a little disappointed, because that's what I'm constantly after. So I love it, and I'm always open to them.
We have one more question here from Sadie asks, how do you put the dresses out of paper on a model without ripping it?
Kind of like the video. You saw how she kind of had to do like this breakdance shimmy into it. There's a lot of shimmying that goes on, and so that's something that I have to answer right at the beginning of making any paper dress, is how will my model enter it. I don't know if we want to go back really quick to answer this question to Madame Beauvoir's painting, where she's looking at the painting and she has the whip marks on the back of the dress right there. Yeah. So this one was interesting for me, because I knew that I was going to want to use the back somehow for the story, but I knew that I couldn't. Usually the back is the entry point for these paper dresses, because you're not going to often see the back of the model. But in this case, I had to be very clever. And so the entry point for her dress, I had to do this dress in two parts. So what she's actually wearing is a two-part dress, is the skirt and then the top part. The top part literally opened like a shell. So on her sides, I created a lace. So she's got two laces on each side of the dress that allow the top to expand and let her come into it. So I literally just expanded it, and it dropped over her. So it's very tricky. It depends on the story that I'm trying to tell, that I want to tell, and what part of the body I want to show. If I know that I can get away with using the back entry, then that's usually how the models get in. Other times, Marie Antoinette is dead. That was actually a full, I would say, 3 or 4 piece dress that I actually put together. So she that's the one where she's sitting down in the blue dress. Do we have that?
We do, it's toward the end.
Oh, there we go, this one. So she's actually wearing a petticoat, you know, like I actually looked at the pattern book for this one and I actually made the full thing. So she had a skirt, you know, she had the petticoat, she had the top part, the corset, and so it was just pretty straightforward where she could just put it on and sit down for that. So it just depends on the story.
Well, thank you everyone for all of these great questions. And thank you, Fabiola, for all, like, for just giving us so much of your time today when I know you're incredibly busy. You mentioned you had a dress that you have to make like in the next couple of days. So I can't imagine how much work that's going to be.
Well, I have 7 days to make it.
We've got lots of applause happening, lots of love coming into the chat here, lots of thanks. You know, I think the thank you so much for this talk, it gives me life is pretty much like that's all you need to hear, right?
Aww, thanks, guys. Yeah. Well, I mean, I think before I leave, if you guys have a second, I think what I want to leave everybody with as just to the students is that I think there's no one thing that's going to be the key to success as an artist. I think the best thing to do as an artist is create what you want to create, and know your creative voice and know what you want to say. You have to have something to say. I think the most successful artists, and I'm not talking about the amount of money they make, I think the most successful artists that create the most amazing work are the ones that know what their voices are and know what they want to say. Once you have your voice and you know that, you can create pretty much anything that you want to create, and it will take on a whole life of its own. And it's very true what they say. You put your energy into making something awesome, and just do that, whether or not you have the money, and all of that money and success will follow. And that's at the end, you'll have to decide if you even want it, right? But if you start there, I think that's the very beginning to success as an artist.
Man, on that note, thank you so much.
Thank you.
That's great.
That's generous advice. Yeah.
Cool. Okay. Well, we're going to go ahead and stop the recording, everyone. And again, this will be posted on our archive. So if you want to go back and reference all the amazing things that Fabiola just told us about,